Well, thank you very much and welcome everyone. On behalf of the Heinrich Foundation, I'd like to thank the economist for organizing today's session. It's a real pleasure to have an opportunity to talk to you a bit about the Heinrich Foundation Sustainable Trade Index, or STI, and the need to build greater resilience. As all of us continue to struggle with the coronavirus pandemic, we're seeing that those countries that pursue sustainable trade policies are almost by definition building greater resilience into their trading relationships and into their larger economies. So perhaps then the best place to start our discussion will be with a definition of what exactly we mean when we talk about sustainable trade. Essentially, sustainable trade is engaging in international trade in a way that not only generates balanced economic growth, but also strengthens social capital and provides for environmental stewardship. We recognize that trade is an essential ingredient in economic development, but it cannot be pursued sustainably. And I would really triple underline that word sustainably without an equivalent commitment to social capital and the environment. Now, of course, these concepts are based on the landmark work done by the 1987 UN Brundtland Commission, which first laid out these three pillars of sustainability: economic, social, and environmental. You might sometimes hear these principles referred to as the triple bottom line, or the three P's: profit, people, and planet. Now, in terms of the index itself, it evaluates 19 Asian economies plus the United States as an external benchmark across those three pillars of sustainability: economic, social, and environmental. We commissioned the Economist Intelligence Unit to produce the index for us. It was based, of course, on a comprehensive literature review, an extended number of expert consultations, and several of what I can assure you were highly intensive workshops that we conducted at the Heinrich Foundation offices. Now, ultimately, what we ended up with was an index which consists of 15 indicators under the economic pillar, 5 indicators under the social pillar, and 7 under the environmental. Now, a very important point. After a lot of discussion and a fair amount of debate, we ultimately decided that each of these pillars would be weighted equally. So that means economic pillar is worth 1/3, social pillar is worth 1/3, and environmental pillar is worth 1/3. Now, if you think we've got that wrong, if you think we've made a mistake, I've got good news. You can go to heinrichfoundation.com. You can download an interactive version of the Word workbook. You can reconfigure those weights any way that your heart desires, and you can rerun the results. So, for instance, perhaps you think it's preferable to give the environmental pillar a 60% weighting, with 20% for environment, 20% for economic, 20% for social. You can go ahead and do that, rerun the results, and see how that will have changed the ultimate ranking of the countries. And we strongly encourage and invite you to do that. Okay, well, let's take a quick look at where we came out as far as the 2020 index is concerned. Now, for the first time, we've had a tie for the top spot between Japan and South Korea. Then we had a bit of a drop-off, and the next four places were fairly tightly packed between Singapore, Hong Kong, Taiwan, and then the United States in sixth place. Now, if you're looking at that sixth place finish of the United States and wondering if that might be a bit of a underperformance, the short answer is yes. We do think it is a bit of an underperformance on the part of the United States. the key thing that dragged down the score of the United States, and it probably won't come as a major surprise to anyone, but it's the large number of tariff and non-tariff measures that the United States has put in place in recent years. So now as we've transition from the Trump administration to the Biden administration, it will be interesting to see the extent to which any of those policies might be changing and what impact it will have on the score of the United States and its ranking in the Sustainable Trade Index moving forward. Certainly something interesting to keep our eye on. Now, as we were putting together the 2020 index, of course, there was a bit of a dark cloud hanging over the whole process, and that was the coronavirus pandemic. And it raised the very obvious question in our minds, which is, well, what impact will the coronavirus pandemic have on sustainable trade? Will it help or hinder the development of sustainable trade? Well, to be clear, I'm quite certain that we don't yet know the answer to that question. I think it's far too early to draw any definitive conclusions. But at least on an initial basis, I can see some reasons that give us reason to feel optimistic, and some factors that give us reason to feel pessimistic. Now, unfortunately, we know that any time countries experience economic duress for any reason, pandemic or otherwise, it can heighten the temptation to try to take shortcuts to growth by trying to roll back labor or environmental standards. Now, of course, this is always a mistake that will backfire over the longer term, but we recognize it is a temptation. And unfortunately, we've already seen examples of countries succumbing to that temptation. In India, several states have reduced labor standards with the specific intention of trying to generate economic activity. And in the United States, during the Trump administration, the Environmental Protection Agency, or EPA, eliminated some of the environmental impact assessments, which typically are required to accompany major infrastructure projects. And in October of last year, Indonesia passed a very significant omnibus reform bill. Now, the Indonesian economy has been hit particularly hard by the coronavirus pandemic. And the reform bill is intended to generate economic growth, economic activity, specifically by encouraging foreign direct investment. And in fairness, there are some very positive things that the reform bill does. It rolls back some red tape. Unnecessary red tape that can make it difficult to do business in Indonesia. And that's certainly a positive thing. Unfortunately, however, it also reduces some labor and environmental requirements. The Indonesian government is essentially wagering that it can benefit by pursuing less sustainability in its policies. Its assumption seems to be that reducing labor and environmental standards will make Indonesia more attractive to prospective foreign investors. There's ample evidence, however, to suggest that that is an incorrect assumption. These old cliched notions, which unfortunately are still kicking around, that businesses are eager to engage in a race to the bottom and to rush in and take advantage of lower labor and environmental standards are rapidly falling out of sync with the realities of how business is done today. More and more companies are recognizing that such an approach simply doesn't make good business sense over the longer term and also runs contrary to the values that are held by its customers, its investors, and even its own employees and the employees that it will hope to hire in the future. And so in a lot of instances, we're seeing now businesses are actually far ahead of governments in their commitment to sustainability. We've started to see a bit of this has become evidenced with the reform bill that I referenced. As soon as the intentions of the Indonesian government became clear, a group of 35 major investment funds with about $4 trillion U.S. dollars in assets under management sent the Indonesian government what was, from my perspective, really a very remarkable and incredibly blunt letter saying, in effect, you are making a big mistake. Don't do this. Reducing labor and environmental standards is not going to make Indonesia more attractive for us to invest in. In fact, you are making Indonesia less attractive for us to invest in. And as I said, I really thought that that was a remarkable indication of the extent to which businesses are now increasingly in front of government in terms of their commitment to sustainability. And I think it gives us reason, at least some reason, to feel optimistic. I'll point just briefly to another factor which I think might give us some reason to feel optimistic. Of course, as we've all seen in the aftermath of the economic slowdown as a result of the pandemic, more and more countries are instituting stimulus programs. And I've really been struck by how many of these stimulus programs make the funding conditional upon the recipients conducting their operations in increasingly sustainable ways. And I think that does give us some reason to at least hope that this whole notion of build back better that we seem to hear every direction we turn in, that it will ultimately become more than just a bumper sticker, more than just a phrase, and will actually take hold, and that we will ultimately build back better and build back with greater resilience. I know that's our hope. As I said, at least thus far, I think it's too early to draw any definitive conclusions, but certainly look for the next iteration of the Heinrich Foundation Sustainable Trade Index. I think by that point, we might be able to draw some more definitive conclusions. I'll draw my remarks to a conclusion there. And thank you very much, everybody, for joining us today. Thank you.